Good morning. Welcome to Christ Community Church. My name is Jason Peters. I'm the Director of Youth and Families. We're so glad you're here on this beautiful Sunday morning. A couple of announcements before we get started. If you're new, welcome. And maybe you came and last week saw what a great party we throw. No, we don't do that every week. There's not t-shirts, and there actually are coffee mugs. So if you would like one of those, please grab one of those. We have a lot. But we're so glad you're here if you are new with us. One of the ways that you can get connected in our church body is there's a tear off in the bulletin. We would love to meet you. We'd love to know more about you. And in that meeting, we can talk about ways that you can get connected through our church body. Also out in the foyer, Chris Musgrove is one of our leaders here. He would love to talk to you, tell you about what all is going on in the life of our church. Also tonight, youth is starting back. From 6 to 8 p.m., we'll be meeting here at the church. So come, we would love to have you. And parents, Rachel, Tucker, and I, we love like going to your kids like soccer games, baseball games, concerts, whatever it might be. We'd love to know those things are going on. We'd also love just to sit down and have a cup of coffee or ice cream, milkshake, whatever it may be, and hear what's going on in the life of your students, what's going on in your family. So let us know if we can ever do that. That's one of the great privileges that we have that we get to do in this job. Also, first impressions team. When you walk in, you see smiling faces greeting you, shaking hands, serving coffee, handing out bulletins. We're in need of more volunteers. We've been making a big push in past weeks as far as technology, but we believe that worship begins before the call actually comes. As you're walking in the parking lot, we need more smiling faces. We need more people serving coffee, preparing communion, doing all these things that help us in our worship. So if you're interested in doing that, you can email Rachel. Her email address is on the advertisement in the back of the bulletin there, or find her. She would love to talk to you and talk about ways that you can get involved in that. God welcomes us into worship this morning, and we often tend to fall into the trap that worship is merely us showing our devotion to God, raising our praise to Him. It is that, yes. But as we come in here and we join in here, God promises to meet us in this place, in His Word, in the sacrament, and in prayer. And in those things, we are being reshaped and reformed. Our hearts are being recalibrated and recentered to who He is. So He calls us into His presence this morning. Would you rise as we read this morning's call to worship from Psalm 40, verses 1 through 3. I waited patiently for the Lord. He inclined to me and heard my cry. He drew me up from the pit of destruction and set my feet upon a rock, making my steps secure. Together, he put a new song in my mouth, a song of praise to our God. Many will see and fear and put their trust in the Lord. Let's pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for the warm welcome into your presence. Father, we come this morning not by any thought or deed, but only by the blood of your Son, Jesus. Holy Spirit, we do now pray that you would come, stir up our affections so that we would worship you in spirit and in truth. We pray all these things in the precious name of Jesus. Amen.
Sing with me.
Come behold the wondrous mystery in the dawning of the King. Be the theme of heaven's praises, robed in frail humanity. In our longing, in our darkness, now the light of life has come. Look to Christ who condescended, took on flesh to ransom.
Seated as we confess our sins together.
From the love of my own comfort, from the fear of having life of worldly passions.
to be understood, and from a need to be accepted, from the fear of being lonely. Deliver me, oh God. Deliver me, oh God. And I shall not want, no, I shall not want. When I taste your goodness, I shall not want. When I taste your goodness, I shall not want.
From the fear of serving others, oh, and from the fear of trial, from the fear of humility, deliver.
Let's take just a moment now in silent confession. The God who has looked toward us in favor and kindness, not because of anything that you or I have done or left undone, but because of Jesus. Let's cling to him, trust him, rely upon him, and offer ourselves to him in confession silently together. Deliver us. Thank you for hearing us. Thank you for loving us, for accepting us as we are, but not leaving us there, that we might be changed, renewed in your name. Give us this blessed hope. We would only look to you. So would you visit us now with your kindness and your mercy and your grace and your Holy Spirit, and teach us to trust you, to love you with all that we are. For the sake of your holy name and the glory of your Father, and by the power of your Holy Spirit. Amen. And let's look now together to Isaiah chapter 53, the hope of the gospel foretold long before Christ. But this speaks of him, and we rest in it this morning. Who has believed what he's heard from us? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a young plant, and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, and no beauty that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And as one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed
for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his wounds we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. This is the word of our Lord. Thanks be to God, and let's stand and worship him together.
Let the King of my heart be the mountain where I run, the fountain I drink from, oh, my song. Let the King of my heart be the shadow where I hide, the ransom for my life, oh, he is my song. You are good, good.
Would you be seated? The fragrance of Christ, his beauty, his glory, it's what animates our worship, even as he intercedes for us and he leads us in worship today. Let's sing of his beauty together.
One of the beautiful things about worship is that each week you come in here, you hear the gospel narrative retold. From the opening words of the call to worship to the closing benediction, we rehearse the gospel. It's in that repetition that our hearts are retuned, we are reshaped and reformed into what God is calling us to do. Similarly, as we recite these ancient creeds, we're doing the same thing. This repetitive repeating of these words, these essential doctrines of our faith, reform us. They call us back to the center of what it is to be a Christian. Would you rise now as we recite with the saints who have gone before us the Nicene Creed? I ask you now, Christian, what is it that you believe? I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he shall come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom shall have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church.
I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
At this time, as always, children are welcome in worship, but if you would like to go down the hall to Sunday school, you are dismissed. You may be seated. From time to time, we love to highlight the missionaries that we support as a church body. Today, we have the privilege of having Russell and Amanda Jeffries, who are joining us. They're coming over from Jacksonville. Russell was ordained in our denomination, and they have been serving in various forms of ministry over the past few years and have a heart for church planting. And that's what they are planning to go do in Ireland as soon as all the paths are clear for that. Give you that. Thank you guys for coming today. Russell, could you tell us a little bit about like what you've been doing and about your heart for Ireland?
Well, absolutely. So in 2000, we began youth ministry in a PCA church in Augusta, Georgia. It's actually where we met and got married. And since then, we've worked in various PCA churches over the last 20 years, doing youth ministry, young adults, eventually just general assistant pastor. In 2010, God has led us to Florida, to Jacksonville, to Pinewood Presbyterian Church. I became on staff there. Was ordained North Florida Presbytery. That's how I know some of these guys. In 2010, and I was on staff there, assistant pastor, doing various things. In 2014, they sent us out to a neighboring community up in Jacksonville, Orange Park area, to plant a church. It was really through that and the convergence of a lot of things where God led us to Surge World Harvest, to go to Dublin, Ireland, to join the team there, to come alongside Irish church planters and pastors, supporting, encouraging, helping facilitate their ministries, helping them be sustainable for the long term.
Tell us a little bit about why you feel drawn to Ireland.
Well, we didn't know anything about Ireland other than like Lucky Charms and Guinness beers, things like that, you know, leprechauns. Surge recruiting us. They saw us as a good fit for the team, our experiences and so on. But when we got there, other than it's just an incredibly beautiful place, we were really struck by this stark need for the gospel. Having been it's a former Roman Catholic country in serious, Roman Catholic in serious decline, but secular humanism is sort of becoming the culture and what it is about. There's only 0.5% evangelicals in the country. To put that in perspective, there's 0.8% in Pakistan. So it's a place where there's really the gospel is needed. But the good news is, too, God is working. He hasn't abandoned Ireland. People are coming to know Christ, and churches are being planted. And so the need to come along, young Irish guys, help them, facilitate, train them, is just something that just God put on our hearts. So some of the things we had been through, particularly in our own church plant experience.
Tell us some of the ways that we can be praying for you guys. How can we support you guys?
Right now, we hope that the Irish Immigration Services has our application, and we think they may even be reviewing it right now. So a very immediate need is like praying that they would approve our application. As soon as we get approval, we're going to start packing our stuff, and we're going to book flights. So that's kind of where we are, and it's been a long journey. It's been over 2 years of us kind of moving through all this with COVID and everything. But we've raised 100% of our support more than once, and the goal keeps raising, and it's raised again, and so we're still looking for monthly partners. So if anybody's feeling led in that direction, we'd love to talk to you. So those are two areas.
Okay.
Particularly.
It's a privilege for us to get to pray for and support our missionaries who are going all throughout the world, to all the nations. I love that you guys feel called to this, that you have a heart for this. Many of us think right now specifically about Ukraine. That might seem like a distant, far-off place, but in our very church body, we have Alan, Larissa, and Alexander Asher, who have family who are in the Ukraine right now, facing all the war and destruction and everything that's going on there. So I'd like to take some time to pray for all of our nations, but for you guys as well. So let's pray together. Gracious Heavenly Father, you are so good, but often we can't see how you are being glorified in the things that are happening in our world. Father, we see the pictures of devastation and destruction in Ukraine. Father, we pray for those people. We pray for their protection. We pray that you would be made known there.
both the people of Russia and Ukraine, we long that all the people of the earth would lift your name and your praise. So, Father, we pray that your presence would be very real there, that you would comfort them and keep them safe. Father, I thank you for the heart that you have given Russell and Amanda, as you have called them to seek the lost, in Ireland. I thank you for their faithfulness in past years, the way that you have been preparing them to do this. You've given them a heart to encourage and to support your church. And we pray that that would be made possible even now through their paperwork as they go to Ireland. Would you open those doors and those pathways so that it would be smooth? And Father, as they transition over to this place they have never known, we pray that it would be a place where your presence is found, that their family is knit together and deeply rooted in who you are. Father, I pray for the marriage of Russell and Amanda. Would it be a picture of your gospel? Would you cause them to lean deeply on one another as they glorify you? Those who they come into contact with, would they see your beauty, your wonder, and your kindness and mercy that you have shown to them, that it would be shown all throughout the places that they are? Father, we pray for the people of Ireland. We want your name to be lifted high there, that your gospel would spread. Father, we thank you for the privilege that it is that we get to participate in the expanding of your kingdom as it goes out. We thank you for the heart that you have given Russell and Amanda. Father, I pray that even now as they're preparing to go, that they would find deep rest in the work that you have done. Father, we know that it is finished because of the life, death, and resurrection of your son, Jesus. Would they find rest in that? But would that also move them outward to go and make much of you in the places that they go? Father, we thank you for all these good gifts. Be with Russell and Amanda and their two boys as they go to this strange land. Would you do great things in and through them? We pray all these things in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. If you guys would like to talk to Russell and Amanda, they will be out in the foyer. You probably noticed the decorative corner that they have out there. Go talk to them. Get to know them, greet them, encourage them. They would love to talk to you. So thank you guys so much.
We have some Irish tea out there if anybody likes tea. And there's some stuff for kids, too. So come on by.
All right. Thank you guys so much.
I think I saw a group of kids running. Just a couple of them were mine, but running in circles around the sanctuary earlier with Irish flags. It's just really fun. So I think they're a hit. Yes. And we're so continue in worship this morning with a giving of our tithes and offerings. And just by way of a simple invitation and introduction to the season that we're in the church calendar, Lent began on Wednesday. Lent is a 40-day period just like Advent. It's a season of preparation. We're preparing for Easter in the same way that we prepare our hearts for Christmas, the gift of Jesus Christ. And this is a similar season in that we begin to look at the humanity of Jesus. But in this case, we walk with him on the road to Jerusalem. We consider his suffering. We consider his temptation, this 40-day period in the wilderness that began his ministry. And I just say in particular, for each of us, this is just a tool. It's a way for us to pattern our worship life here and at home after the gospel of Jesus and to realize that Jesus is a man who bore witness to our suffering by enduring every ounce that we deserved as sinful people. Not only that, but he can relate to our trials. He can relate to the places in our world that are broken and hurting because he chose to walk through them as a person. He did this for you and for me. And he invites us again to come to him and bring him everything that we are and everything that we have that we might become more like him. And this is only his work, and it is our privilege as a church to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ today. So would you sing this with us? This song is called, Oh, the Deep, Deep Love of Jesus, as we consider his love today.
Lost our nation.
Stand together and give thanks to his holy name.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above the heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Amen. Would you please be seated for this reading of God's Word?
Sermon's text is from Matthew 5:17 through 20. Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. For truly, I say to you, until heaven and earth pass away, not an iota, not a dot will pass from the law until all is accomplished. Therefore, whoever relaxes one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called the least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does them and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. This is the word of the Lord.
Good morning. So good to be together. Before I get started, I just wanted to say a couple first thank yous. Last weekend, really the weekend before that, we just celebrated, if you weren't with us, our 25 years together. I just want to say thank you. There were so many people that contributed, from making cookies to decorating cookies. The Tuckers, they joined the church the week before, and then we said, can you feed 500 of us next Sunday for their first Sunday as members of our church? Thank you guys for serving us so well and sharing and organizing our team and our staff. You did such a great job serving us. So thank you. It was a great day together in the life of our church. And when I took Scotty Smith, who is our preacher and pastor, last Sunday back to the airport, we were in the car, and he just said, Tim, he said, this is a pretty special place. And I said, I know, Scotty, it really is. He said, God is really at work in your church, and it's pretty obvious. See, because I go to a lot of different churches, and it is really evident that he is working in this place. And so I say that to encourage you and for us to encourage one another to continue to seek after Jesus together, to continue to commend what we cherish and he be what we cherish together as a church. I wanted to tell you, as just one last announcement, next Sunday in between the services, we're going to have a congregational meeting. We do these quarterly. We'll update our budget, our spending. Great news. One of the reasons why we celebrated was we just paid off our mortgage. We mentioned that a couple weeks ago, but we are 100% debt-free, which gives us freedom, like to support missionaries around the world and ministries, which is super exciting. At the end of the year, in the middle of a COVID season again, we far exceeded our spending and we're over budget, which gave us such freedom and capacity to give away. We also have some growth in our staff and ministry. So we can't wait to share with you all those things that are going on. We'll do that next Sunday in between the services. So if you normally get here at 10, we all know everybody gets here at 10:50. We start at 10:45. Try to come. We're going to start that right after the first service, about 10:10, and hear some of the things that are going. We'll try to record it. So if you can't be here, you can at least hear about it. But God is doing some really neat and beautiful things in our midst. Let me pray for us. Gracious Father, you are good to us, and we thank you. Thank you for the opportunity and privilege to be here. Left to our own devices, Lord, none of us would be here. But you have called us to this place, not to hear from Tim, but to hear from you. So we pray now, Lord Jesus, would you speak to us? Would you be our teacher? Would you help us behold the beauty of your Son, Jesus, and the hope that he offers anew and afresh in the gospel? Help us believe it is true. Protect Christ's community and our friends and guests that are here, for my sins are many. Would the things from Tim fall on deaf ears, but the things that are yes and amen because of Jesus, help us not just hear them, but believe them, and not just believe them, be transformed by them. So Holy Spirit, help us, we pray. Amen. We are in the midst of a series on the Sermon on the Mount. That's in Matthew 5 through 7. It's the greatest sermon ever preached, and it is Jesus' longest teaching passage in the gospel. It is, Jesus is announcing salvation has come full and free in the gospel of Jesus Christ. And this announcement of salvation in the gospel of this Sermon on the Mount, Jesus is giving this blueprint of life in the kingdom, a life that will bring blessing to those who believe it and blessing to those that are around us. This is the announcement of God's kingdom through the Sermon on the Mount. And this particular pericope or section of the passage that we're going to look at today, we're going to look at what Jesus has to say and to teach about the Bible. What is his doctrine, if you will, of Scripture and the Bible, and how important that is for life in the kingdom. And I want to start by asking us this question. Has God left us in cosmic spiritual confinement? Has God left us in cosmic spiritual confinement? That is, does he speak to us? Does he leave us alone? It's a question of lots of film. Sure, there was a movie several years ago with Amy Adams called Arrival. It's a sci-fi movie, but all over the earth there are these ships, these sci-fi spaceships that show up. And she is a world-class linguist, and her job is to go in and can she communicate? Can she communicate and find out what these people that are beyond us want or have to say? That's a question, not just for film, but in Christianity. Is there one that is beyond us? Is there one that is beyond one that we can see or touch today that has something to say to us? Does he speak to us? Does he communicate to us? Or does he leave us in cosmic spiritual confinement, in silence, wondering and guessing? Well, Christianity and the Bible is resounding, yes, God speaks. God speaks most particular through his Son, Jesus Christ, in the word of flesh, so we don't have to wonder, what is God like? What does he love? What does he care about? What does he not like? Injustice. We know that because God revealed in the person of Jesus Christ. But he doesn't end there, because this is amazing. As Christians, as those who believe in him, God doesn't just say, okay, I reveal what I'm like in the person of Jesus Christ. He gives us the Scriptures. And he tells us that the Bible is living and active. And it reveals his heart. It reveals his beauty. It reveals his kingdom. And this is amazing for those who believe in Jesus Christ. It says that the Bible is not just any other book, but when you open it, you can commune and have fellowship with the one who made you. Isn't that amazing? The one who created you, who knows the hairs on your head, you can commune with him. You can hear from him. You can speak to him. And he gives you this access to him, which is an amazing gift in Christianity. So I want to look at today in the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus' doctrine of Scripture in this passage. First is kingdom righteousness. Because Jesus says something at the end of this passage in verse 20 that should make all Christians pause and become nervous. And this is what he says. Unless your righteousness exceeds the righteousness of the Pharisees and the scribes, you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. And that should make us pause. Just to feel the weight of it, it would be like if I said, okay, guys, if we are going to experience and have the kingdom of heaven, you must live a better moral life than Mother Teresa. Now, all of us are familiar with Mother Teresa, right? She gave her life in service to the slums of India. And if we have to have acceptance with God, if he's only going to accept us and acceptable in his presence, if my moral record exceeds that, I'm in big trouble. You're in big trouble. And this is what Jesus is saying. He says, unless your righteousness is as good as the Pharisee, these professional law keepers who had over 600 laws and rules that they said, okay, I'm going to make a chart. Someone had to do that, right? Let's make a chart. Let's make a graph. Let's get all the laws on some paper and let's have some check marks and let's have some box and we'll have these laws, over 600, over 300 commandments. 1,500 things that they would abstain from just to not get them close to breaking commandments. They weren't even breaking the commandments. It's like, we don't want to be close to those, so let's do these 1,500 things and to just keep us from getting close to them. That's crazy, isn't it? But this is how they lived, and Jesus is announcing the kingdom, and he says, you want to be a part of the kingdom? You want to be a part of me? Your moral record and behavior needs to be greater than those professional religious types. And for Christians, for people that are in the church that are like, hey, we're giving our lives and devoting to walking and worshiping and believing Jesus, is there should be pause here, right? Because he's saying if your record isn't better than that, you're in trouble. And what Jesus is saying, what he's pushing on the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, is he is saying, I want more than outward behavior. I want more than just a moralistic record. I want more than just checking a box. I want more than that. Jesus is after not just our moral, not just our rote obedience. Jesus is after our hearts. Jesus wants right action. We've done this before, actually. If you imagine a triangle, he wants right action for the right reason and for the right motivation. My wife, I can tell you, you can do the right action, and if the right reason and motivation are wrong, it doesn't matter. My wife, it was her birthday this last week. What if I just, imagine with me, right? I didn't remember, I forgot, and then on Saturday, Anna says, hey, Dad, while you're at Target getting a few groceries, don't forget, stop by the one spot. They got those $1 things at Target. Maybe you could get something for Mom for her birthday. And then I come home, right, and I say, hey, Robin, I forgot, Anna told me. Here's a nice journal. It was in the one spot at Target. Hope you like it. How is that going to work? It's not going to go well. It's not. That's not going to go well. Or let's just say I say, okay, on Friday is my day off. I'm going to do the dishes, and I'm going to fold the laundry. And then after I do all that housework, I'm going to take a picture of the clean living room. I'm going to take a picture of the dishes, and I'm going to send it to my wife, and I'm going to say, you're so lucky to be married to me. Right? That's not going to work. Why does that not work? Why does that? We all know that doesn't work. I did the right action. But the right reason to love my wife. The right motivation. Because God has called me to love and serve her. But the right action is there without the right reason and without the right motivation. Jesus is saying, that's what I'm after. I'm after all of these things. The right action, is he want us to be obedient? Of course. What's the right reason? To glorify him and to seek his kingdom. What's the right motivation? Jesus loves us. He's given his life for us. He's rescued you this morning. He's made you his son and daughters. And out of that love and grace and goodness and mercy, yes, we want to be obedient. Yes, we want him to receive glory, but it's because he first loved us. And he, to the Pharisee, is saying, if you just check the box, if you just do the outward behavior, that's not good enough. I want the center of your being. I want your heart. I want your affections. I want what you love. And there's only one who can sit on the throne of that. And it can't be about doing it so other people think, man, that guy's pretty good. It has to be because you love him because he first loved you. And that's what Jesus says. This has to exceed that. But then he goes on in not just that kingdom righteousness. Look what he says about kingdom law. In verse 17, I'll pick up there. He says, "Do not think that I've come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. For truly I say to you, until heaven and earth pass away, not an iota, not a dot will pass away from the law until it all is accomplished." At the most basic level, Jesus is saying he's the fulfillment of the scripture. In Luke 24, when he's talking to the couple after he's resurrected on the road to Emmaus, he says, "All the law and the prophets, they were about me." That means from the very beginning of the story in Genesis 3:15, when it says, "From the seed of the woman will come one that will crush the head of the serpent." In Exodus, when there's a Passover lamb, that judgment and death will pass over us. This looks forward to the one that will come where God will pass over. In Leviticus, where there needs to be a priest and a sacrifice, Hebrews tell us that Jesus is the great high priest, that he's a better sacrifice. In Numbers, where the rock has to be struck. In Judges, where the people do what's right in their own eyes and they all need a king. He's the king we long for. In Joshua, he's the only one who can take us into the promised land. I could keep going, but Jesus, every page, whispers his name. And he's the fulfillment of the whole biblical story. And when he says, "I'm going to fulfill everything, every comma, every period, you can take it to the bank, I will fulfill this. I am the fulfillment of the story." This is what Jesus is saying. Now, don't miss this, right? Because what he says in verse 20, if you put that in concert, what he says with the fulfillment of the scripture, this is so beautiful. Because here's the pinch for us, right? Must exceed the Pharisees. We're in big trouble, right? The law exposes us because we know that sin is real. We can look on our phone. We can look on social media. We can look inside our own heart. Sin doesn't skip over my heart. Sin doesn't skip over your heart. We got a problem. I know that's not what my heart is like. And Jesus, at this moment, when you're righteousness must exceed. It is like someone bringing you a bill and you realize, "Oh man, I forgot my wallet at home." In his presence this morning, that's our dilemma. We don't have that righteousness. We have a bill that can't be paid. But this is what he says. Who can pay the bill? Jesus' response is, "I will. I will fulfill it." And in Jesus Christ, he lives the life we were supposed to live. And he dies the death that we deserve to die. And he's resurrected from the dead so that we can know him and be in relationship with him. The first Adam came to the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, and he grasped and grabbed and brought sin and death and shame and guilt crushing in this story. And it impacts every one of us. But the second Adam comes not to a living tree, but a tree of death. And he doesn't come grasping, but he comes empty-handed, pierced to a dead tree, not bringing sin and death and guilt and shame. But through his life, death, and resurrection, he brings new life. He brings healing. He brings hope. He brings resurrection. And he pays a bill that none of us can afford. And so the dilemma in this passage and the beauty of the gospel is, who has righteousness that exceeds the Pharisees and the scribes? None of us. But we have one who's willing to pay the debt for us. He'll fulfill it. Every iota, every period, every comma is yes and amen in Jesus Christ. This is beautiful. In the gospel. A few years ago in 2012, there was a man named Christian Smith who's a sociologist. He's not a Christian. He just studied trends in Christianity, and he did this project, "What Do Christians Really Believe?" And in his project, he has this saying of what really people who describe themselves as Christians believe, and he described it as moralistic, therapeutic deism. Moralism is then people who claim to be Christian. Moralism is they believe you have to be a good person. That's what a Christian would be. They would say you got to be a good person. therapeutic in that there's some good things about Christianity. It could help you be a better dad. It could help you be better at your job. There might be some good wisdom and nuggets in here about being generous. That's therapeutic. Deism, there's some creational design. We can see, we can look at the creation. We can see a baby being born. There's things that don't make sense. There's got to be some kind of God out there. The majority of people in churches that are in pews believe you must be a good person. Christianity offers a few good tips, and there's probably a creator. Do you see how upside down that is compared to what Jesus is saying? He's saying, who's a good person? None of us. He's saying we need something more than just being a good person. We need atonement. We need rescue. We need washing. We need new life. We need hearts that are moved to stone and be made hearts of flesh. And in and through the perfect life and death in Jesus Christ, he can transform us. There's no one that's too far gone. There's no sinner that's too far of reach of his grace. He can make you new. But we need his rescue. We need his hope. We need more than some wisdom of like, I can be a better dad. That's not helpful. That's not the gospel. We need grace and redemption and atonement. And that can turn all of us upside down with his grace and goodness. And that's what he is announcing when he says in every single part of the scriptures will be fulfilled in Jesus Christ. That's why as in our church, at Christ Community, I'm gonna give you a little secret. 3 weeks ago, if I said, hey, do you guys remember what we preached? This is what we preached. That the life and death and resurrection of Jesus Christ is so beautiful. That if you believe it and you hope in it and you cling to it, it'll transform you. If you see your need for a rescuer, not to be a better person, not to take a few tips, but if you see you need a rescuer in Jesus Christ who can make you new, this is the hope of the gospel. I'll give you another cut. You know what we're gonna preach in 3 weeks? I haven't studied. I haven't opened my notes, but I'll go ahead and tell you. You should still come. But I'm going to tell you in 3 weeks of the hope, of the beauty, of the life and death and resurrection of Jesus Christ and his fulfillment of not part of the law, his fulfillment of all of it. And how if you believe it, if you cling to it, if you hope in it, it'll transform you from the inside out. That's what Jesus is announcing. That's what he is saying when he says every part of the law is fulfilled in Jesus Christ. It'll change us if we believe it. Look what he says in finishing, because he doesn't just end there. The last part of this is what he says in kingdom transformation. Let's look at verse 19. Therefore, whoever relaxes one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does them and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. So someone could say, okay, Tim, if God fulfills the law, and he does, if he fulfills the requirements of the law, he does God not care if we're obedient? Should we just do whatever we want to do? And that's no, right? He's after right action for the right reason, for the right motivation. He says, even though he's the fulfillment of the law, blessed is he who obeys, who teaches, who does these things. So the hope is not just that Jesus transforms us the way he does in the gospel. It is true. But then the scriptures, they change our affections and desires. 2 Corinthians 3:18, Paul says it like this. We with unveiled faces, that's those who have been able to behold the gospel of Jesus Christ, are with ever-increasing glory, being transformed by the Holy Spirit to be more and more like the Son. This is good news, but Jesus, through his scripture, transforms us. It's not just that he fulfills them, which he does, but through this fulfillment, he changes our affection, and the word can transform us. There's power in this. There's communion with God. There's relationship with us. He doesn't just rescue us from our sin to avoid judgment. He does do that. He rescues us from our sins so we can enjoy communion and union and fellowship with him. And so then the scriptures, this is why the psalmist says, oh, Lord, I love your law. It's not because the law brings salvation. It is fellowship. It's transformation. This is what we long for it to do, God's word to transform us, that it would go out of a place of deep love for what Christ has done, of seeking his kingdom and glory, and then we would long to be obedient and serve the one who has made us. I'll give you a couple practicals. Here's two. There is power in this, and there's beauty. The power of the Bible, and as we enter this season of Lent, this would be a great thing, is like, how do I find time to spend time with Jesus in the scripture? For the next, the preparation as we move towards Easter. If you need a Bible, I'd love to buy you one. If you need to know how, where would I start reading my Bible? I'd love to talk to you about that. Or one of our elders would love. I'd start in the Gospel of John, but just find time to read your Bible, to see God revealed in the scriptures. It'll change us. It'll transform us. Find time to fellowship and to commune with him. He loves you. He wants to be with you. And so do that. And in this, we see this same model in Jesus Christ in his life. In Jesus' greatest moment of temptation, how does he respond to Satan in his temptation? He quotes scripture. And what does he do in his greatest time of suffering, agony, pain, and death on the cross with such horror? What does Jesus do as his comfort? He quotes scripture. Now, I'm just going to confess about my own heart. This is when I was a kid, you know, you go to the dentist. You haven't brushed your teeth in like a week. Kids, this is true. And your mom's like, you're going to the dentist and you run in there and you floss real quick. And then you go to the dentist and they're like, Tim, have you been flossing? And you're like, yes, you got the thing in my mouth. I can't talk, but yes, I've been flossing. And he said, well, why are your gums bleeding? When you get like 3 feet from your gums, they're bleeding. And you're like, I don't know, because I haven't been flossing until this morning when I went to the dentist for the first time. A lot of times my heart is like that with Jesus in the scriptures. Suffering shows up, temptation shows up, difficulty shows up, and I'm like, where's my Bible? There's such an opportunity to have union and to enjoy his beauty and goodness and grace. This is how Jesus, what he does in his own life, and it will transform us as his people. And then there's beauty. This is what we long for, the affections of the heart to be transformed by beauty. The scriptures are not as much a castle to defend as a mansion to move in and invite friends. It's not so much a castle to defend as much as a mansion to move in and invite friends. They're beautiful. Last week when Scotty was here, he mentioned his mentor, Jack Miller. And in our little pastor crowd, Jack Miller's a really big deal. He had a huge impact. He started World Harvest Missionary, where our missionaries for today are going to serve with Surge and where Josh Dickinson is in Uganda. He planted tons of churches, but he had a reputation of just loving Jesus, of having an affection for him. And so I asked Scotty, we're at breakfast, and I said, what was Jack Miller like? And I was just praying, like, you know, he's one of my heroes. That, like, please don't tell me he was mean and rude. And I said, what was he like? Like, what was Jack Miller like? And he said, Tim, I'll tell you a story, and this will tell you all you need to know about Jack. He said, he's staying at our house, and I'm off to work. My wife is gone. The kids are gone. He's left at our house. And I forget something, and I have to go back to the house to get it. And I kind of forgot that Jack was there, and I came bursting through the door. And when I came through the door, there in the living room, Jack was on his hands and knees. He was praying. He had his Bible open, and he was worshiping. And he said, Jack was an amazing Bible teacher, but his public worship was not outdone by his private worship. The beauty of the one who has called us. One of my prayers for us as a church is Psalm 26:8. Oh, how I love the dwelling place of the Lord. And I pray that for us, that we would long to come in here on Sunday morning and give God the worship and glory he is due, but I long for that when no one else is looking. When no one else is around, when no one else is watching, what do our hearts long for? And I pray that our hearts would long for the beauty and goodness of Jesus. Let me pray for us. Father, you are good and you are kind. And I pray that you would help us as a church long for your dwelling. We would long to be with you, Lord, and we would come into your presence not full of shame or fear, because you have fulfilled the fullness of what the law requires. But Lord, make Christ's community a people that run to their daddy in the middle of the night to ask for a drink of water, because we have access to your goodness and grace through Jesus. Make us a people that long for your dwelling. And Lord, would you grow our affections and our love for the beautiful gift of your Son and the grace of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Let us be known by our love in every word and every deed on earth as sun. Let our light shine in every eye. Let us be known. Peace.
One quick announcement before you go. We have tons of coffee mugs out there. So even if you got one, take one, give it to a neighbor and say, hey, come check our church out. If we don't get rid of them, your 35th anniversary mugs will say 25th anniversary. I'm just saying. Grab a coffee mug, receive the Lord's blessing. Would you go? And the love of God the Father, and the grace and mercy of his beautiful son Jesus, and the fellowship of Holy Spirit, go in peace.
His soul.